You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Tuesday, February 11th, 2020. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. It is New Hampshire primary day. Polls opened 5 hours ago. In fact, in some places, 12 hours ago. On the program today, Dave Weigel, to commentate on and report on said primary. Also on the program today, Bill Barr acknowledges he has quasi-deputized Rudy Giuliani to investigate Hunter Biden. Finally, the nation is secure.
Learned my lesson.
Meanwhile, prosecutors seek 7 to 9 years for Roger Stone in prison for obstruction of justice. Trump administration goes to war with our states over immigration. National poll. Sanders, Biden, Bloomberg? 17 points. Meanwhile, the House votes on Thursday to open the door for the constitutional amendment of the ERA, extending the deadline. Meanwhile, the Trump administration redirects anti-trafficking money to political allies, or I should say, away from organizations it doesn't feel has towed the administration line. Also, the Trump administration blew up native burial sites for their dumbass wall. All this and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. We didn't do much of a budget rundown yesterday of the proposed budget by Donald Trump. We will get into that, I would say, over the coming days. It's obviously we are dominated with political coverage at the moment, or I should say electoral coverage. But the Trump budget, though it will not pass because the Democrats control the House, it does give you a sense of what we could anticipate in a second Trump term. And I suspect will also be an electoral tool for Democrats in the fall. We will get to that, but too long didn't read. Spoiler alert, cutting Medicare, cutting Medicaid, although they've already basically begun the process of cutting Medicaid in terms of its block grants, and cutting Social Security. Are we streaming the audio?
There's something going on with the audio computer, so we're recording it now. We're hoping to get the stream up soon.
Oh, okay. Can we put out a tweet or something like that? You got to let me know if we're having that type of problem. I can't hear from Kyle. Kyle's too upset about it. He already texted me. We're having a little bit of technical difficulty with our audio-only stream, ladies and gentlemen. The bedrock of our show. But getting back to the electoral politics at hand, of course, New Hampshire is a... This is pretty big because this is basically where Joe Biden can get eliminated from the race. It also has, I think, big implications for Bernie Sanders. If Bernie Sanders does not come in first, a solid first, I think it's going to be a problem for him. I think Elizabeth Warren has to come in third to stay viable. I think this is the last hurrah for Pete Buttigieg. And Amy Klobuchar, I don't know what to tell you. I mean, I have no idea. I mean, when Sanders wins, if, but it's very likely that he wins, you're going to see a tremendous amount of poo-pooing his victory. I understand why people get upset about this, but understand that it's really, if you support Sanders, it's not necessarily a bad thing. There is a certain delusion that's going on with a certain segment of the party, and that is that they have been unable, and it gets worse almost every day, to coalesce around an anybody but Bernie candidate. And it appears that Michael Bloomberg has been soaking up all of the resources. He's literally meeting with big donors, not because he wants their money. He doesn't need it. He's a billion. He's like, how many billions of dollars is he at? 65, something like that. He drops $1 billion on this campaign. I mean, like, I'm trying to figure out, like, what is 1/65th of, like, my net worth? And I feel like it's like, you know, it's somewhere around, like, me buying a new car or a couch is somewhere in there. Somewhere in between there is 1/65th of my net worth, maybe. Maybe closer to a couch. And not a terribly expensive one. And for him, that's a $1 billion worth of a campaign. I don't know. I got to figure it out. Couch. Yeah, maybe a decent couch. And he is soaking up all of the campaign staff and all the resources. He's telling donors don't donate to Joe Biden. Soon, Pete Buttigieg will suffer the same fate, I think. But there's a real problem with Michael Bloomberg. And I've heard, you know, you hear a lot of anecdotal stuff like, I like Bloomberg. Well, Mike Bloomberg has spent several hundred million dollars in basically having just ads that extol his virtues and has dealt with really no criticism. He hasn't been on the debate stage. If you watch TV, if you're watching MSNBC in the morning, Steve Rattner literally manages his money, but then opines about what a great guy he is. I got news for you. If you want to give me the fees on managing your $65 billion, or even just like $2 or $3 billion, I'm probably going to have some positive things to say about you. Now, one of them will not be that you pick your money managers well, but aside from that. But here is why Mike Bloomberg, just exhibit A of literally, I don't know, 20, like you go, I think, like, I feel like you go to like at least like GGG as you go around the alphabet and present all these exhibits. But this is one indication of just like, we can point out there's multiple reasons why he will lose various sectors of our population, but various regions, right? Where he just will lose outright in a general election. One of it is that his policies in New York City were about as close to explicitly racist as you can get. And his justifications for them, even when he knows he's talking more or less in public, exhibit that. Let's go back to this. Here's Ben Dixon of the Ben Dixon Show, has dug up we're talking 5 years ago. This is not 1955, some time when Bloomberg went to the Aspen Institute and expanded upon what he thought should happen with the Negro in the city, as it were. This is 2015. At the Aspen Institute, he gave a speech, apparently Bloomberg had the video blocked, but somebody audio taped it.
95% of your murders and murderers and murder victims fit one MO. You can just take the description, Xerox it, and pass it out to all the cops. They are male minorities, 15 to 25. That's true in New York, it's true in virtually every city in America. And that's where the real crime is. You've got to get the guns out of the hands of those people to get killed. So you've got to, you want to spend the money for a lot of cops in the street, put those cops where the crime is, which means in the minority neighborhood. So this is one of the unintended consequences is people say, oh my God, you are arresting kids for marijuana that are all minorities. Yes, that's true. Why? Because we put all the cops in the minority neighborhoods. Yes, that's true. Why we do it? Because that's where all the crime is. And the way you get the guns out of your kids' hands is to throw them against the wall and frisk them. And then they start, they say, oh, I don't want to get caught, so they don't bring the gun. They may still have a gun, but they leave it at home.
All right, let's just go through this. I mean, aside from the fact that his 95% figure is incorrect, the idea that because most murders happen in within a specific demographic means that you have license to take every member of that demographic and criminalize them. And by criminalize, I mean make them subject to treatment that they would get as criminals. I mean, for instance, if we were to say 95% of white-collar crime involving finance is done by people on Wall Street.
Or Bloomberg terminal users.
Or Bloomberg terminal users. And so therefore, what we got to do is randomly send people downtown. They go into, J.P. Morgan Chase. They go into Bank of America, Wells Fargo. They go into Goldman Sachs. They throw the guys down on the ground. They put their boot on the back of their backs as they shuffle through their computers to see what's going on in there. They take their phones and they check and they see what's on WhatsApp. They giving any insider? I mean, this is just absurd to criminalize an entire population. And incidentally, we've also shown that the absence of stop and frisk has in no way increased the crime. Because the bottom line is, it was probably just a coincidence. There were other factors, because crime dropped everywhere, almost everywhere across the country and, frankly, the world. A lot of people associate that with the lack of lead that we were spewing in the air with leaded gasoline. Because neurological disorders are a huge indicator of potential crime or just antisocial behavior. But the idea that this guy is going to motivate the most important voters the Democratic base has. Are you kidding me? Here is Michael Bloomberg again. This was in 2013. Now, I can't remember. Was he an independent here or was he a Republican? I can't remember when he switched because he found it to be most helpful for him. But here he is in 2013 defending racial profiling. Here is a guy who does not look at other people as human beings. He's not capable. It's just, these are just numbers. I mean, this is like McNamara's level lack of humanity here. It's just a sheer numbers game to him. The number of lives ruined, I can get my stats down.
They just keep saying, oh, it's a disproportionate percentage of a particular ethnic group. That may be, but it's not a disproportionate percentage of those who witnesses and victims describe as committing the murder. In that case, incidentally, I think we disproportionately stop whites too much and minorities too little.
We're talking about making, in this particular case, young black men feel like they cannot go out into society without being immediately suspicious, essentially. They cannot walk amongst the civilian population and feel like they aren't in some way a target. This is super effed up. Super effed up. And his stats, I think, are also wrong. I don't have them, but I think his stats are overblown. But that's not even the point. Even if his stats were correct, 95% of black people are not committing crimes. 95% of black men, black boys, 16 to whatever it was that he said, 25, are not committing crimes. But you're subjecting 100% of them to the type of scrutiny that you do a criminal. It's disgusting. It's disgusting. It is sociopathic in its own right. There's just absolutely no sense that who he's talking about are human beings who have lives, who have mothers and fathers and sisters and brothers, and ultimately will have kids, like will go through their lives. It really is stunning. So F. Michael Bloomberg. Appreciate your knocking Joe Biden out. But once that's done, maybe you should use your money for something different. Really, just, oy. Hey, folks, you're a couple of days away from Valentine's Day. Did you buy a present yet? Probably not. Luckily, there's something that can help it and make it date night all throughout the year. I'm talking about Hunt a Killer. It's an activity you can experience with your loved one every month. Roll up your sleeves, work together to solve a realistic murder mystery. Obviously, it's not exactly the same pitch, but my daughter and I do this and it's super fun. Super fun. She got into like, she was watching, she was like constantly doing Law and Order things. And I told her about this and she was just like, it went through the roof. It's the only time she talks to me. Hunt a Killer thrusts you and your friends or family into an ongoing murder mystery investigation. The game brings people together by challenging them to decode ciphers, examine clues, solve puzzles. It's like an escape room delivered right to your door. Hunt a Killer has 2,000 five-star reviews on Trustpilot, and Fast Company named them as one of the most innovative entertainment companies of 2019. Plus, part of the proceeds for every box goes to Cold Case Foundation. Mile and I have a flow chart. What do you call it? It's not a flow chart. I get the string and the tax. And it was all about a murder that took place at a reunion. I'm not going to tell you anymore. A college reunion. It's fun. It's fun. I mean, I actually think it helps with some of her like reasoning skills. And it's the only thing that she does is not on the phone for like more than 5 minutes at a time. Right now, just for our listeners, you can go to huntakiller.com/majority. Use the promo code majority at checkout for 20% off your first box. They send you a new box every month. So it's like a new episode almost, as it were. Head to huntakiller.com/majority for 20% off and show support for this program. That's huntakiller.com/majority. All right, folks, quick break. Right back with Dave Weigel.
Some people think they're always right. Others are quiet and uptight.
We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report. Ladies and gentlemen, when you want to know what's going on electorally or prior to an election or after an election, regardless of where it is around the country, there's one person you want to talk to, and we have him on the phone. He is the political reporter for The Washington Post, Dave Weigel. Dave, welcome to the program.
It's good to be here. Thank you, man.
Now, Dave, you work for the CIA. Pete Buttigieg works for the CIA. How did you guys pull this thing off in Iowa?
You know, just the usual taking over the machines, even though there weren't machines in the caucus rooms. You know, that made it a little bit trickier, but we found them. What else? PSYOPs, spiking the water supply with acid. A couple of coups. You know, a couple of key county parties where we replaced with Venezuelan aristocrats.
Right.
So, you know, the usual. I mean, nothing fancy. Like, if we're pretty good at this.
No, you guys have got this down. But seriously, you know, I don't want to spend too much time on it, but what do you think? I mean, obviously the app failed, and there was obviously like some, I understand there was some like Trump fans who were clogging up the lines on the reporting. But what do you overall, like, what's your sense of like what went wrong there?
So I'll confess, I was slow. Maybe this is why I'm not in a very lucrative industry where you calculate risk and make lots of money. I was pretty slow to realize that there was a huge problem, because what you're doing on election night is calling the campaigns, checking in on their numbers. And in Iowa, the campaigns do their own surveying, as the Sanders campaign pointed out. They had no idea the party was screwing this up. It's not like a state election where people are turning in numbers to their county offices. This is, they said, okay, well, you know what's going on, so we'll wait for the Democrats to figure this out. So I was surprised by that. And when I realized something was terribly wrong, it was probably closer to a 10 p.m. in Iowa, when other reporters who were in the filing center figured it out. And so I've been maybe not as obsessed with this as I should be, because my look at Iowa was, hey, it is a story of momentum. It's a story of who gets in the top few spots, who collapsed. We know that already. The delegate fight is interesting, but we kind of have to move on to other elections and let right. the campaigns deal with it. So my own time has been spent mostly on the pivot to New Hampshire. But that's been affected by Iowa. I honestly think as much as Sanders and Buttigieg each got a little bit of momentum cut from what happened there, I think it was bad for Elizabeth Warren that the story coming out of it was not, hey, somebody who was being written off came in third and beat the vice president, or the other stories you normally get. But I was kind of slow to realize how bad it was.
Yeah, I mean, talk about that. So, I mean, that makes sense to me, because from your perspective, it's really it is what it is, and it's going to have an impact on the next election. So you felt Warren, because I do think that it was close enough that, you know, you mm-hmm. could make an argument that Buttigieg would have gotten a bigger bounce, because they love to tell that story of somebody who came out of nowhere, more or less, to win. And there was an anticipation that Sanders would win. But it seems to me that Biden was the only one who came out with a very clear narrative, which was he lost. Like, that to me seemed clear from day one and continued mm-hmm. to sort of hold up.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's always tough to adjust your priors, right? And so what can do it is a gigantic surprise. I don't think the Biden loss at that scale was surprising, because, frankly, Biden, you know, if you do your work, you're talking to campaigns, seeing candidates, you saw that Biden was getting very small crowds, that there wasn't a ton of energy, and you saw sort of atmospherics, like my colleague Holly Bailey was very good at pointing this out, just other campaigns had county organizers, precinct captains, months and months in advance, who knew their stuff. Biden's campaign often had people who'd flown in to help him from Delaware and were introducing themselves to local Democrats like a week before the caucuses. I mean, they were just getting out campaigned, but the Biden folks were still spinning. Look, he has broad appeal, and all these caucus rooms, people are going to have him as a second choice. So they were wrong. They overestimated themselves. And I think it took a while for people, in the press even to adjust to how badly he'd done, because the story, even some of the thinking, I think there's a very good political story on this by Mark Caputo, who everyone should read if they want to read Biden coverage. I mean, he's this great, smart, sharp Florida-based reporter. And it was just saying, he dodged a bullet, was I think the term, that he did badly, but people didn't realize he did so badly because of the Iowa mess. But the reasons he did badly were repeated in New Hampshire, that it's just not a very well-organized campaign and the candidate does not generate excitement. That did not change after he came out of Iowa. And as I think everyone saw this week, last week, I lose track of time.
Right, I understand.
I know what Tuesdays are. But in the last few days, people noticed, while other candidates came to New Hampshire, put their boots on and said, okay, we're going to go everywhere in the state. You know, Amy Klobuchar and Pete Buttigieg kind of leading the field on that. Biden had a couple events, and then he went dark for 2 days. And you see today, as we're talking, that Biden has announced, after saying he was going to be at his New Hampshire victory party, he went and changed it and is going to South Carolina tonight instead, leaving supporters, you know, get out the vote people, to get the vote out for a candidate who's giving up on the state. those were problems in Iowa. They're going to be problems going ahead for him. I mean, he could have a comeback of some kind, and the campaign will engineer that. But if you're paying attention, all the problems that manifested in Iowa were just there screaming out to be noticed.
What do you make of the fact, you know, it's funny because I have a friend who lives up in northern Massachusetts, and he said, you know, we were going to go up and see some Biden events, and he doesn't seem to be even campaigning. Like, he said this to me 4 or 5 days ago, and I said, that must be, you just have the wrong sheet of paper. There's just no way he's not going to campaign for 2 days. That doesn't make any sense. What was that about?
Yeah, so he went back to Delaware, which as somebody from Delaware I support generally, and had meetings with campaign staff, reshuffled the campaign, put forward Nita Dunn, who was both an Obama media aide and helped shape some of Harvey Weinstein's defense. Let's leave that aside. But he put up somebody who's, I think, a little bit more adept at the grip and tackle of dealing with the media, dealing with rapid response, fighting. And you saw after the debate, he released this video hitting Pete Buttigieg, but a video online, not a TV ad. And you saw the problems here. So Biden, he did indeed leave the trail. He did fewer events. But in the time he had, his strategy was one that he doesn't seem to be very comfortable following. He just is not naturally a negative campaigner for himself. He was a pretty good negative campaigner for Barack Obama, and he's dismissive of other candidates, but he will sometimes have attack ready to go. The campaign team will tell reporters he's going to do this tonight. He doesn't do it because he's really confident that he can rest on his record. I shouldn't say rest. You know, he's a long record. Talk about what he did with Barack Obama, talk about his Senate work, that should be enough. He doesn't go negative as naturally. But I think that was what they spent those days doing, is coming up with a strategy that kind of executed, but the candidate himself has not been very adept at executing.
All right, lastly, I don't want to spend too much time on Biden, although, but what's your sense of, mm-hmm. We heard from a couple of people on the day of the Iowa caucus, maybe it was the day before, that she was one woman had told us that she knew a field director who was working for Biden and then got scooped up by Bloomberg, paid like $6,000 a month and went up to Michigan. How much of that is going on? Because I keep hearing anecdotally that's happening everywhere and that it's starving like even other, not just presidential campaigns, but sort of like local campaigns of staff workers, because he's just throwing around an enormous amount of money.
Oh yeah. Well, it's certainly, you know, those movies where the world is ending and people build like a giant raft or ark or something and they bring people on. I mean, that's kind of the Bloomberg campaign for political staff at other campaigns. So a lot of Kamala Harris people jumped on, a lot of Cory Booker staff jumped on, Steve Bullock staff. So people who might otherwise have gotten out of the presidential field and worked for a Senate race or a lower level race, they suddenly have a much more glamorous and high paying job with Bloomberg. That's something I'm interested in. I think Ryan Grimm, The Intercept, has been fishing around for examples of this. But yeah, I think naturally this is going to take some people who might have been straightforward political operatives out of lower races and, you know, and into this, kind of taking advantage of Democrats had over Republicans, because a there is a lot of talent being scooped up by the Trump organization, by the RNC, less for down ballot races where Republicans have been underperforming. So I can see some of that. The advantage Democrats have, though, is there are just such wide networks of grassroots activists, a lot of whom are not involved with the campaign, a lot of whom organizations that are currently working for Sanders in the primary. So I don't see it as a huge crisis for all campaigners. I see it as something that might be siphoning away mid-level campaign talent.
All right. So let's talk, turn to New Hampshire here. Amy Klobuchar, it felt like she had a bump coming out of Iowa. I was up there Friday night for the debate, and there sort of felt like people were excited about her. I mean, it feels like there is the Sanders people are sort of locked in. Maybe he's picking up a few, you know, as he goes. But everybody else seems to be just jumping around a lot. Is that the sense that you get?
Yeah, I think so. Keep in mind what New Hampshire is. It is not a liberal state. It is getting more Democratic, but it is not like Massachusetts, not like Vermont. It has a preponderance, a plurality of registered voters are independents. Actually, independents, I think Republicans still marginally outnumber Democrats, but independents have been voting for Democratic in 2016 and 2018. And with only a token race for president, you know, there's Donald Trump on the ballot, there's Bill Weld on the ballot, there's some other guys you've never heard of. There are independents, about 400,000 of them, who are free to do whatever they want. The president himself has encouraged them to vote in the Democratic Party for the weakest candidate. It is not clear who Republicans actually think that is. Remember when they tried this in 2008, it was let's vote for Hillary Clinton over Barack Obama. They've tried it in other situations. I think the general sense for Republicans is let's cause some trouble and vote for Bernie Sanders. At the same time, you have a president who's been taped saying that Sanders is the candidate he worried about in 2016, right? So I don't know who they might actually vote for. The president didn't specify. But there are more people who will vote sincerely. And I met them, frankly, a lot of people at rallies for Buttigieg and for Klobuchar over the last week. Those independents were interested in Biden's campaign, and those are the people I think that fell off the fastest. You know, they wanted to vote for a strong Democrat to beat the president. They don't like the president. They looked at Biden. They thought it was him, and they got scared because they think he's just falling apart, that he looks weak on the trail. So I think that is where the movement is going to Klobuchar and to Buttigieg. I don't think much is going to Warren. The polling's been all over the map. She's been fairly solid, in third place. And the question has been if somebody moves up 5 points, moves down by a few points, if they would beat her for third place. That's a whole other discussion because it's about delegates. But when it comes out to where the moderates and the Biden voters are moving, it is absolutely to Buttigieg and Klobuchar. I mean, Michael Bennett is still here trying to make some things happen. I have not seen much
Michael
in that
Bennett.
Direction.
I forgot hey, Frank, about him.
He's still here.
Oh.
Making literally his last stand here. I mean, he said if he does not place in the top four, he is going to drop out, and he is not.
I was going
to
say
top four. I mean,
what is the betting line on that? Because I feel like that is a one bet I would try and make that this could be it for him.
He said so. I mean, he's actually gone to be and said, I need to place the top four. This is it for me. Yeah.
Yeah.
But anyway, the point with him and everyone else is, yeah, there are options. And I think what you're going to see, maybe skipping ahead, what you're going to see on Wednesday, if Sanders wins, especially if it's not super decisive, let's say he wins by 6 points or something, the spin will be, well, he won because moderates divided themselves between too many candidates. Look at all the votes he lost from last time. I think that's what the spin is going to be. And it will be not crazy because you will have had a state where independent moderates can vote. And they will have said, okay, we are undecided about which of these two or three candidates we want. But if Biden drops out and there's just two moderates and Warren, it could get interesting. I'm not saying Biden's about to drop out. I'm saying if he really keeps tanking, those voters might fly off faster than people thought. And there's an idea that no one else has appeal with black voters. That is not wrong so far. but no one has tested a race for black voters without Biden in it.
Right.
And there are a lot of fairly moderate black voters in these states who had a chance to look at Sanders all year, decided they're not really on board with it. Black voters over 30 generally have been resistant to him. So we don't know where they'll go, but black voters in New Hampshire are not a huge factor.
Let's just talk about just general turnout. But before we get there, actually, let me. So you're saying that Biden would have to drop out before Nevada and South Carolina, right? Because if he drops out just before, let's say, Super Tuesday or after Super Tuesday, Mike Bloomberg comes into the picture in Super Tuesday, correct?
He does, yes.
So there's
Mike Bloomberg jumps in. He only got onto the ballots in states after the first four, and he's on all the ballots for everything after the first four states.
So it's unlikely that we'll ever have a situation where it is just Klobuchar and Buttigieg, right? Because Biden's going to stay in for South Carolina. I mean, there's no, if he was going to drop out, he would have dropped out before New Hampshire if he's not going to stay in for South Carolina. And right?
Yeah.
I mean,
that's a reasonable assumption. Yeah.
And so after South Carolina, the next up is Super Tuesday. And so even if Biden drops out, then it's going to be Buttigieg and Klobuchar and Bloomberg. So they're never going to have like this open field that they keep thinking that they're going to have.
No, that might be true. And so after Super Tuesday, so Super Tuesday will be important because some candidates may wash out and run out of money, and there actually are a lot of delegates after Super Tuesday. So the popular number is 40% will be chosen. There's an idea that no one will get 50% of all the delegates. I think that's a little bit overstated. I think it is very easy to imagine a race. I'm not going to say which candidates would get the most, but a race where the primaries end and one candidate got 40% of the delegates and the next behind him or her got 30%, there'd clearly be a effort to say, okay, we have somebody who has the most support from the party. How will we fix this up? Maybe this person will choose a running mate who got the second biggest amount of delegates. Like this, honestly, for all the panic about how this would work, I think there's a rational way through it. But when it comes to how they will go on Super Tuesday, yes, there's a risk, one hand, that multiple candidates, Buttigieg, Klobuchar, Warren, Sanders, let's say it's them with the juice, that they're all in it and that none of them have a huge advantage apart from Sanders in places like California and Colorado and Vermont and Maine. So you could have a real mix there. I think the X factor is really just it used to be. If a candidate was bombing out, they stopped raising money. A candidate like Amy Klobuchar, I think, might have suffered something like that because she came in fifth in the state next to hers. She got to New Hampshire. If she didn't win here, she might run out of money. But there are a lot of big donors who'd be freed up from Biden. There are a lot of small donors who really do like her. I mean, one thing, we all learned this in 2018. You know, we can fight about which wing of the party is ascendant, things like that. But we saw in 2018, you can raise a ton of money without being a Bernie Sanders style candidate. There are these House candidates that would raise $7-8 million, not running on much of an ideology, just saying we need to stop Trump. So there are a lot of moderate donors who can keep people alive. And there is a risk for moderates if none of them drop out and they just keep splitting and splitting. I think there would be a pressure on some people to quit after Super Tuesday because we have this direct example of what happened with the Republicans, where John Kasich and Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio all refused to quit. I think the Rubio of this situation, whoever that would be, I don't know who it would be. Let's just, you know, Klobuchar or Buttigieg or Warren. If one of them came out of Super Tuesday with like one state win and said, I'm still in this, I think the pressure would be on them to stop. But I'm sketching out a scenario where there's a big division still, where there's not a two candidate race.
All right. Let me ask you a couple of other questions about I want to get to turnout in just a second. But do you, when we talk about, you know, I mean, you know, you talk about moderate candidates and we talk about, you know, as opposed to Sanders, are you finding that voters that you talk to see those same type of lanes, or are those lanes that they talk about, are they just drawn in a different way?
So they exist. There are lots of voters you meet who say that New Hampshire, again, with all these independents, is different, interesting for this. But there are voters you meet who say, I think Sanders and Warren are too left, are too far left wing. That's something that's been a problem for Warren, is that she is more moderate in some ways, but people don't see her that way. You do meet people who say, I'm for Klobuchar or Buttigieg because I think, oh, sorry, or the other way around. I'm not for them. I'm not for Klobuchar or Buttigieg because I think that they're too centrist, they'd lose. You meet some of those people, but you meet a ton of people scattering who, just because they like a candidate for some other reason, they don't have a big theory of how to win the election. So you meet a lot of Klobuchar Yang voters, Gabbard Bennett voters, like Steyer voters and Bloomberg voters, who, if you poll them on policy, don't always agree with them on everything. But like the idea that there's a rich outsider who can really take it, the fight to Trump, that's interesting. So I think maybe a majority of voters do not fit narrowly into lanes. That means that maybe a third, two-fifths of them do, but there is a lot of flirtation around lanes. I think the people who do fit in the lanes are the donors. And donors are pretty right. adept at knowing who is going to not threaten their wealth with higher taxes, and they know who, if you're a small dollar donor, who is for free college, who is for Medicare for all. That money, I think, is that money moves in lanes more than I think the voters do.
Now, everybody you talk to that you just, you know, when you were just sort of mouthing what they're telling you, is all trying to anticipate what is going to work in the general election. I mean, that seems to be, it seems relative to in the past. Let me ask you this way. Is there, do you have a sense that there's just a heightened sensitivity to this than there was, like, I guess, you know, I guess we're talking 2008, really, or 2016?
Sensitivity to what's the this?
Yeah. To
what's the this?
A sensitivity to how this person's going to do in the general election, as opposed to like why I think they're just a good candidate. Like how much of it is, you know, projecting out from, or is that always been the case? And I'm just more aware of it this time.
No, it's more this time. So a stat I love to point out from 2016 in New Hampshire is that Bernie won the state by 21 points, but about by a 3-1 margin. When asked who they thought was more electable, voters thought Hillary Clinton was. They just didn't think electability was a huge issue that year, because they said, well, I like Bernie, I agree with him, I think Hillary's gonna be the nominee anyway, and anyway these people can beat, at that point they weren't sure who'd be, but this people could be either a messy Republican field or Donald Trump. That has been flipped around completely. Voters are thinking a lot about electability. Now, the disadvantage of Joe Biden is that they are not saying the candidate who keeps saying he's electable is electable. Less and less they're saying that. But people are definitely prioritizing what they think their neighbor will vote for in a way they were not in the past. I think that I've seen that in Iowa. I've seen some of that here. I think I've seen a little more freedom from voters moving around than I saw in Iowa. But that is a concern that was not there last time, and it is now.
Do you, and maybe it's, you know, more difficult for you to get a sense of this sort of cohort, but when we look at the Iowa turnout numbers, they've been revised upward, I guess, you know, over time as you try and figure it out, that they actually were slightly better than 2016. My understanding is that the youth vote was something like even higher than 2008, but the general turnout was not as big as 2008. Do you think that there's a cohort of people who are just like, I subscribe to this idea that the person who I would vote for is the person I think would win in the general election. But to be honest, I can't make that determination. So I'm going to sit this one out. You pick somebody, I will vote for them in the general. Mm-hmm. Do you have any sense of like that mentality?
I didn't hear a lot of that, frankly. Now, I should say that some Democratic county chairs in Iowa were warning that you're hearing it. They had neighbors who were like, I'm confused, there's too many candidates, I'll vote for whoever the nominee is. They heard that anecdotally, but I don't think that was as big of a factor as, you know, people have for all the talk of how united they are against Trump, there are people who left the party, and Iowa was a place where they did that. The registration for Democrats is not terrible, but there are a lot of older white voters who just bailed on them for the Republican Party after 2014, and they didn't all come back. So that's why I'm kind of reserving judgment on that for New Hampshire. Certainly the exhaustion with the campaign, with Trump and with the candidates, I think that's moving a couple of comfortable voters off the, back on the sidelines, but not a ton. I think it's more that, I would like to see what happens in some of the states where Democrats have lost more ground or where they've gained more ground. For example, West Virginia, which Hillary Clinton won in 2008 and Bernie Sanders won in 2016, the Democratic turnout was way, way down because people had bolted out of the party. So for the excitement people had about Sanders doing well there should have been tempered for lots of reasons, but one being that voters clearly were not interested in voting Democratic in the fall. But in a state like Virginia, which votes on Super Tuesday, in a state like Nevada, which is gaining population fast and really Democrats are dominant in the state now, I want to see what the turnout is there. Underlying all this, though, the Sanders theory, which is different than some candidates' theories, is Democrats lost the working class. We didn't give anything to vote for. We're going to give them a reason. The people who don't vote, the people who are not registered, the people who think politics is stupid, we'll give them something to vote for and they'll vote for us. That has not quite been happening, but it's only been one state. But that is the number one thing I have my eye on.
Right. Is that the youth that came out, that's not indicative of that? I mean, I guess maybe it's just a question of which cohort. I mean, the idea is that the theory is they're bringing out low propensity voters, right? Like low propensity voters, however you define that.
That's true. Yes, that's definitely true. That would help in swing states. But one of the premises of Sanders is there are white working class voters who are waiting for a real progressive message and they'll abandon Trump. I'm not trying to be blasé about it. I mean, it's more complicated than that. But in 2018, that didn't happen. They had people, you know, very famous candidates like Randy Bryce and Jess King. And there were less famous candidates like your Matt Morgan in Michigan. People who won the nomination, Dana Balter in New York, people who won the nomination on Medicare for All, and they got, some looks from The Intercept or progressive media at, let's see if this person can pull this off. And they just didn't. There just was not the same willingness to it the way, and I'm not making a direct comparison, but I've seen this happen with Republicans or they'll have, this is the candidate who's going to go down there and make inroads with Latino voters. And they can't because they're running as Donald Trump's Republican Party and people are too polarized now. So I think that was a source of worry in Iowa. And then for the party writ large, most of the party is not behind Sanders right now. The party writ large, they're just worried about those people being kind of sleepy and saying, I'm just tired and exhausted. It's a real thing. I mean, for voters who are not, let's be frank, their lives will not change that much. Their lives did not change much in the last 4 years. So, you're not an immigrant. You're not a woman who has had your health care plan changed and contraception taken away. There are more comfortable voters, comfortable middle class, upper class voters. Definitely some of them just don't feel the same stakes and they just hate watching Trump on TV and they want him to go away. They have not been as engaged in a candidate or as an issue or with an issue because right. They'll say, well, I'm worried about the party picking a bad one, but I want somebody who'll make the orange man go away. And that was frankly a premise of the Biden campaign is those guys want Biden because he will make Trump disappear. It just has turned out that not everyone's convinced Biden can do that.
Right. I mean, it was almost like for all intents and purposes, we won't have a president. And it, at least it won't be Trump is basically
the
Biden pitch.
This was the Michael Bennett pitch. I think it was like Matt Crispin called that the most black-pilled thing he'd ever heard. When I'm president, you won't even realize he's a president for weeks at a time. So the idea, we don't need an activist president to do things. We need somebody who will stop yelling on TV all the time.
I think we can't underestimate that impetus that is going on. And it's, I remember it, frankly, I remember it in 92. People were just psyched to get the Reagan era over. And, George Herbert Walker Bush was just seen as an extension of that. And everybody was just sort of, there was just a sigh of relief with Bill Clinton. And I remember just looking around going like, really? I mean, yeah, I think that's a certain inevitability. And I think that would have happened with Bush to some extent as well, if there was a VP candidate, if Dick Cheney ran, let's say.
If Dick Cheney ran, I understand.
Well, if Dick Cheney had run as a third George W. Bush term, I think there would have been a different feeling about, you know, how we were going to elect that president. But there was no even like remote incumbent in 2008. So sort of building on a different there was a different dynamic, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think there was. And look, it's obviously, I think people are – I don't want to overstate this, but I do say – I've met the people who just resent that they have to pay attention to politics all the time, and they resent that more than any particular thing affecting them. They would like to see Trump gone, and Democrats tend to despair. I mean, I've been doing research for other things during the course of the primary, and that's kind of new. I mean, Democrats had a confidence in 1992 when George H.W. Bush was polling at like 60, 65%. That they were going to beat him. Right now they'll see a poll where Trump is at 40, 47 or 48, and they'll say, oh no, we can never win. And it is incredible that they have that lack of confidence. But
well,
if you're a fairly comfortable voter, you can look at that and say, well, I don't want to think about this. Let me go watch something on TV.
To be fair, we've had two elections where the popular vote winner in the past 20 years, where the popular vote winner lost. So that 46%, it really sort of depends on how it's distributed on some level. And I would also add, Bill Clinton did not get 50% of the vote. People forget this, but the guy won with 45, 44% of the vote. And so, you know, if
some is rational. I'm just saying there was more worry even than there used to be about this because you've identified because people have won the election, like the kind of vote total that would win them any election except for presidential election because of the Electoral College, and that that would naturally cause a trauma.
So, all right. So New Hampshire, we know what the polling is. Right now, it looks like Sanders, Buttigieg, and then I guess Warren and Klobuchar and Biden are all sort of like, bunched together there. Mm-hmm. And Biden, I mean, even if Biden goes fifth, right, like you can't leave the state. I mean, part of the reason why they got to be leaving the state is to sort of like already sort of, you know, when you go to them, go like, are you guys devastated? No, you know, Dave, we weren't even trying in New Hampshire. It's really all about South Carolina for us. But let's just talk about Nevada for one moment, because the presumption has been that, you know, Sanders and Warren are going to have, have the strength in Nevada on some level. I think that's been the presumption. But how much is the... We had a call the other day from who was a member of the culinary union there. That is a very powerful union in Nevada. And he had sort of indicated that people, you know, his brother-in-law or something, you know, was worried about losing their health insurance. And then subsequent to that, I saw that the union, I don't know if they've made an endorsement or not at this point, but they were starting to sort of get a little bit worried about the idea of losing their health insurance in a Medicare for all thing. What do you have a sense of what's going on there, or are you just, you know, you haven't been there and, you know, recently enough?
I haven't been there. I mean, it's not just labor leadership. I mean, this is I think an ongoing issue for the left, because there is a lot of intersectionality. There is a lot of progress, frankly, being made in unions supporting Medicare for all, not just the nurses. There are a larger number of labor unions that believe this argument, which I think has a lot of merit. If you look what happens in other countries, if you take healthcare out of negotiations, workers will have more to bargain about, more bargaining power, less that can be taken away when they're collectively bargaining. I get that. But not every union's on board yet. And the ones that are not on board, I mean, just the usual man bites dog theory of what's newsy. I mean, it's not news anymore when, like, Sarah Nelson or Roseanne DeMauro or Larry Cohen, one of these other union leaders, says, I love Medicare for all. It is news when some union says, hey, we're left wing and we like Bernie Sanders, but he's going to scare us and take away our health care. So I think that still gets a lot of attention, and there's still a lot of work that has not been done to flip those people and those unions. Now, among rank and file, I think there's a bit more convincing that has been done, but not enough to shake them out of the fear that if they endorse Sanders or Warren, they would get nothing. And I think there's also some of this is sublimated worry about their electability. Mm. It's just so hard to compare this to 16. Again, I've been repeating myself and talking about the confidence that Clinton would win. But Sanders was just a free vote for a lot of people because there was no sense that we want him to get as many votes as possible, as many delegates, but he probably won't be the nominee. Let's move the party in the right direction. I think there is some harder thinking now happening with these groups.
Interesting. Anything that we left on the table, Dave? Is there something else that we should know?
No, I think that's it. I mean,
are there any particular bellwethers? Like when you watch tonight, what's the first thing that you're going to like pay attention to? It's not that place, Knobby Creek or wherever it is at midnight. What is the one that you're
so much? No.
Kristen, what is the first thing that you look for?
Well, it depends what comes in, but I mean, I'm basically comparing results from what we saw in the last primary and the last election here. So Bernie Sanders did well everywhere, but there are some actually places like Hanover where Dartmouth is and people academics, people who live in a college town were more loyal to Hillary Clinton. I'm seeing where they're going. I'm seeing where the more working class towns like Manchester, like Berlin, Berlin's very small. I'm seeing where they go. I think Nashua, and also places like Bedford, the suburbs of – well, Nashua is a city that's been getting more and more Democratic. Bedford's a classic example of a place that was a pretty Republican suburb that has become very skeptical and flipped to Democrats. So I could start just naming towns forever, but I'd say basically look at some of these suburban towns where Republicans win the general election and look at some of the left-wing towns. The thing that I'm still trying to calculate is – where are the moderate independents or the conservative independents going to – what are they going to do? So in Rockingham County, which is kind of the Republican redoubt of the state, it's got all the towns where people fled Massachusetts for lower taxes and easier access to guns.
Yes.
Like your Derrys and Salems and things like that. Watch that area. I mean, I'm just interested to see where that's trending because if they're – I'm not expecting actually many people to go out and troll a vote for Sanders. I think if Buttigieg is doing very well in those areas, if he's capturing people who would have voted for whoever the moderate candidate is, I think that's going to be very telling. And same thing with Klobuchar. Like she spent the last couple of days kind of crisscrossing, but like look for those towns where she wouldn't have done very well a week ago, but people might have bailed on Biden. So you know, again, Salem, Derry. Milford, places like that.
Okay, interesting. All right, Dave Weigel, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. I talked to you, and I feel like in addition to having been mind control because of your CIA background, feel like I have a better sense of what's happening up there.
Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, all I know about New Hampshire is you can run a packy run on Sundays. So.
I don't know it as well as I know Iowa, but I guess I'll never be back in Iowa again, given how things went. So
Dave Weigel, always a pleasure. Hope to talk to you again soon.
Thanks, man.
Thanks. Oh, and folks, got to sign up for the trailer. Sign up for, we'll put a link where you can get his email. Now is the time, ladies and gentlemen, to listen to the trailer. Matt, since you looked at me like you didn't know what I was talking about, there used to be, I don't know if it's still the case in Massachusetts, blue laws, which means that you can't sell alcohol on a Sunday and because of the Puritans. And so what a lot of people would do is go up to New Hampshire, right across the border, they would have sales tax-free booze. So you load up your car. and you bring it back to Massachusetts. And if you forget that you don't have any booze on a Sunday, you take a little ride.
It was called a what?
Packy. Package store, dude.
Okay.
Packy run.
Okay.
That's what they call alcohol, you know.
Package store.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's where you buy your booze. Take a packy run. Go right across the border on like 93, I think it is. There's like a huge state liquor. It's like an emporium. It's unbelievable.
Sounds amazing.
Yeah. No, it's really sweet. Should check that out if you ever go up there. Folks, just a reminder, this program relies on your support. Oh, wait, before we even get to that, I should tell you about tonight. Tonight, we're doing live coverage of the New Hampshire primary. And joining us in studio, Noma Keys Const of the Noma Key Show. I feel like I practice how to say your name. For years, I said Nomiki, and it turns out to be Noma Key.
You know when you close your garage door, but then you need to run out of it without hitting the sensor? That's what you pronouncing that name is.
Exactly.
Like.
And I feel like maybe like one out of three times I bang my head on the top of the garage door as it's coming down, knocked out, and the thing sort of lands on me and then bounces back up. But Noma Key will be joining us. We'll also, I think Jamie is supposed to call in just a few minutes. To give us a report from New Hampshire.
She saw the stroke show, I think.
Yeah, I think that's basically what she's going to give us, a review of the stroke show. And Jack Crosby, who writes for the AM Quickie, will be calling in from New Hampshire. We may hear from Virgil Texas tonight. It's possible, unless he's eating a salad.
He says he wants to call in with his prediction in the fun app.
He wants to call in with his prediction in the fun app?
He wants to call in with his prediction, and he wants to make sure that you hype it before he does so.
We are the podcast of record for
that's
the
right.
live.
That's right, exactly. All right, well, fine, we'll do that, like Tim Russert. So stick with us. We'll be back. We're going to probably start streaming tonight about 7 p.m., and we'll go as long as it takes for us to get the results from Iowa, even.
We'll actually get results this time.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the case. In the meantime, don't forget this show relies on your support. You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. Folks, we've just basically done this. We're going to roll it out soon. Video on the app. For members. And in fact, members can get video on even the iTunes podcast app. They can get video.
Like the full show?
Or do you I don't think we're going to do the full show yet. We got to test that out, see if we can get it compressed enough. But extra bonus videos, full show, we have links to. But we're making the member experience even more glorious. So join themajorityreport.com. You won't believe what we're going to have for you coming in the weeks and days. We're going to have a special hotline for phone calls, for members only. Yeah, no, things are getting crazy around here. So check it out. Join themajorityreport.com. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. And listen to the AM Quickie. Go subscribe. It's completely free. You can listen on the app or you can listen any podcast thing. You can subscribe to all of it via amquickie.com. Again, free. Just a reminder, Hunter Killer, the activity that allows you to work as a team and investigate crime in the comfort of your own home. It's the badass murder investigation where you decode ciphers, where you examine clues, you solve puzzles, you figure it out. If you're like me, you get the board with the tacks and the red rope. Go to huntakiller.com/majority. Use the promo code majority at checkout for 20% off your first box. That's huntakiller.com/majority. Promo code majority. Check it out. Also, don't forget to check out The Noma Key Show. It's on YouTube and Patreon, patreon.com/TheNomaKeyShow. Also, TMBS will be live tomorrow night, but you can catch last week's show at patreon.com/TheMichaelBrooksShow.
TMBS.
TMBS. I'm sorry, youtube.com/TheMichaelBrooksShow. And also, don't forget the Antifada, patreon.com/TheAntifada. And Matt?
Brand new episode of Literary Hangover dropped yesterday. A big long one. Yeah. The History of Colonel Nathaniel Bacon's Rebellion by Ebenezer Cook. It's a 1728 poem. Among other things, you get to hear about how George Washington's great-grandfather committed a war crime at the beginning of that. And we also talk about sort of economic anxiety and its links to Indian hating. So check that one out, folks.
There you go. See you in the Fun F. Jamie and I may have a disagreement.
Yeah, you can't just say whatever you want about people just because you're rich.
I have an absolute right to mock them on YouTube.
He's up there buggy whipping like he's the boss.
I am not your employer.
You know, I'm tired of the negativity.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to upset you. You're nervous, you're a little bit upset, you're riled up.
Yeah, maybe you should rethink your defense of that, you fucking idiots.
We're just going to get rid of you.
All right.
But dude.
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 You want to smoke this joint?
Yes.
Do you feel like you are a dinosaur?
Some good shit.
Exactly. I'm happy now.
It's a win-win.
It's a win-win-win.
Oh, hell yeah.
Now listen to me. 2, 3, 4, 5 times. 847-906-501-457. 2, 38, 56, 27. 1/2. 5/8. 3.9 billion.
Wow.
He's the ultimate math nerd.
Don't you see?
Why don't you get a real job instead of spewing vitriol and hatred, you left-wing Limbaugh?
Everybody's taking their dumb juice today.
Come on, Sammy.
Dance, dance, dance.
Ooh. Grandpa.
I had my first post-coital scene with a woman. I'm hoping to add more moves to my repertoire. All I have is the dip and the swirl.
Fine, we can double dip.
Yes, this is a perfect moment.
No.
Wait, what?
You make under $1 million a year. You're scum. You're nothing.
Excuse me? Fuck you, you fucking liberal elite. I think you belong in jail.
Thank you for saying that, Sam. You're a horrible, despicable person.
All right, gonna take a quick break. I want to take a moment to talk to some of the libertarians out there. Take whatever vehicle you want to drive to the library. What you're talking about is gibber jab.
Classic. I'm feeling more chill already.
Good.
Donald Trump can kiss all of our asses.
Hey, Sam. Hey, Andy. You guys ready to do some evil?
Hitler was such an idiot.
I think I might be a Nazi.
Agreed.
No.
Death to America.
You.
Yes.
Wow.
Wow, that's weird. No way! Unbelievable. This guy's got a really good hook.
Throw our hands up.
Ooh.
Wow.
But Sam, I gotta get off.
No worries. Let's I wanna just flesh this out a little bit. I mean, look, it's a free speech issue. If you don't like me.
Hey, shut up!
Thank you for calling into the Majority Report. Sam will be with you shortly.